this is purely on Ulster sort of men who died on Armistice Day 1918. I thought it was an interesting thing because we have a lot of people, you know, talk about this. And from what I understand, either the French or the Belgians refused to record any war fatalities for the 11th of November 1918. United Kingdom took a different approach. And on this date, on 11th November 1918, within the British Dominion and Empire forces, there were 860 deaths. Now, some of these were guys who had been discharged and died of as a result of their war service. Many of them died while still in on the Western Front or in other theatres of war. But it doesn't really matter. I mean, whenever you look at the range of places where they're buried, it runs from China to Belize to different parts of Africa. But there's 860 deaths from the British, the overall British Dominion and Empire forces. 327 of those are commemorated or buried in France, Belgium, and Germany. And whilst the approach, the armistice took place, there were still a lot of men who were prisoners of war and would remain prisoners of war until December 1918 and even into 1919. So there's 327 commemorated, buried in what we could generally call the Western Front area. And of those 327, 18 fatalities were from Irish regiments. Some of those would not have been Irishmen, and of course there would have been Irishmen with other regiments, as we'll see as we go through. All but two of these, the men I'm going to talk about tonight, have a direct connection to Ulster. A couple of them, the connection is a bit vague. So I'm going to start off. There's two fatalities who were serving with 6th Battalion Royal Enniskilling Fusiliers, and they're buried in the Busigny Communal Cemetery Extension in France. The 6th Enniskillings was part of the 10th Irish Division and landed at Suvla Bay on the Gallipoli Peninsula on 7th August 1915. The division was redeployed to Salonika in October 1915 and also fought in the Palestine Campaign 1917-1918. The 6th Enniskillings left the division in May 1918 and was deployed to the Western Front, and it was part of the 50th Northumbrian Division from July 1918. So two men from this battalion died on Armistice Day 1918. The first was Dennis Docherty, who was born on 12th July 1885 at Culhane on the Inishowen Peninsula in County Donegal. His parents were Patrick Docherty and Mary Docherty. Dennis married Elizabeth Martin on the 25th of December 1909 at St. Columb's Roman Catholic Church in Londonderry. In 1911, Dennis and Elizabeth and their daughter, also Elizabeth, were living at Bridge Street in Derry, and Dennis was employed as a shop porter. Lance Corporal Dennis Docherty died of wounds at the age of 33. Elizabeth Docherty was living at Bridge Street in Londonderry when she gave birth to their third child on 11th May 1919. Obviously, Dennis had a period of home leave during which Mary had become pregnant. She was awarded a pension of 29 shillings and sevenpence from May 1919 for herself and three children. She also received a war gratuity of £24 in August 1919. When I'm going through these, wherever possible, if I've either got a photograph of the man or a photograph of his headstone, I will use that. But where I don't, I'll just use basically whatever I can find that's relevant. Second one, also from the 6th Enniskillings, was Joseph Watterson, who was born on 21st October 1884 at Malvern Street in Belfast to John Watterson, who was a shipyard labourer, and Alice Weir. When he was 2 years old, his mother died of tuberculosis in March 1887, and his father subsequently remarried to Mary Sempe on 15th March 1889. Joseph married Eliza Ann McConnell on the 23rd of December 1906 at St. Anne's Parish Church in Belfast. And they were living at Memel Street in 1911. Joseph Watterson was 34 when he died of wounds on Armistice Day 1918, and he's commemorated on the memorial tablet for St. Patrick's Church of Ireland in Ballymacarrick. Eliza Ann was living at Convention Street when she received a pension of 20 shillings and 5 pence a week from June 1919. She subsequently remarried a man called Jonathan Templeton on the 18th of October 1919 at Knock Breeder Parish Church. Two Ulstermen from 2nd Battalion Royal Irish Rifles died on Armistice Day 1918, and they are buried in the Terlincan British Cemetery at Wimille in France. William Irwin was born on 28th February 1888 at Kell Street to Hugh Irwin and Anne Morris, and the family lived at Mount Collier Road in 1901 and then at Fortingale Street in 1911. William enlisted with the 17th Reserve Battalion of the Royal Irish Rifles and was deployed to France with the 9th Battalion in October 1915. He also served with the 10th Battalion of the Rifles, and Commonwealth Wargraves records that he was serving with the 2nd Battalion when he died of wounds at the age of 30. Now, whilst the 2nd Battalion was a regular battalion and was in one of the regular divisions of the British Army, by 1918, both the 1st Battalion of the Irish Rifles and the 2nd Battalion had been brought into the Ulster Division. When William joined the 2nd Battalion isn't known, because his service papers have not survived. The second man from the 2nd Battalion was Robert John Johnston, who was born on 31st January 1895 at Ligonier to Richard Johnston, who was a flax spinning master, and Emma Baird. There were several spinning mills and linen mills in the Ligonier area, including Ewart's Mill. Ewart's were the big family in that neck of the woods. In 1911, Robert was a yarn tester, and the family was living at Legland Street in Ballysalon, Ligonier. He enlisted with the Royal Irish Rifles and was deployed to France with the 15th Battalion in October 1915. Corporal Robert John Johnston died of wounds at the age of 23 and is commemorated on the memorial tablet in St. Mark's Church of Ireland on the Ligonier Road. Two Armistice Day 1918 fatalities are buried locally in Belfast City Cemetery. Their graves are not marked with headstones, and their details are inscribed on the memorial wall. They're buried in what is known as the Roll of Honour Ground, which was a plot of land which was purchased by the War Office for the burial of servicemen, where the families could not afford to provide them with a burial plot. First one is David Harris, who was born on 14th March 1884 at Knock Row near Ockram in County Roscommon. His parents were Grimes Harris and Jane Cowan. He was living at Sydenham Avenue when he married Jane Kears from Cypress Avenue on 4th September 1902 at St. Patrick's Church of Ireland in Ballymacarrett. David and Jane had six children between 1903 and 1916. David was a coachman when he enlisted with the Army Service Corps on the 18th of April 1918. He came to the war even later than most Americans. He was serving at a depot in Woolwich when he was discharged due to general paralysis of the insane on the 28th of August 1918. He died at Purdiesburn Asylum at the age of 34 and was buried in Belfast City Cemetery on the 14th of November 1918. There's no headstone at the plot, as I said. On the same day that he was buried, Jane Harris gave birth to their seventh child, Victoria Gladys, quite possibly called Victoria as a consequence of being born on Armistice Day, Victory Day. Jane Harris received a pension of 42 shillings per week from November 1919, and that equates to £120 per week in current terms. William Higgins was born on 6th March 1895 at Wilton Street to William Higgins and Maria Jane Kells, and he was a mill hand in 1911. He was a window cleaner when he enlisted with the Royal Enniskillen Fusiliers on the 7th of July 1914, and he was deployed to 2nd Battalion on the Western Front in May 1915. He was wounded in February 1916 and hospitalised for a month. In September 1916, he was admitted to No. 13 General Hospital with gunshot wound to the right leg, right arm and right hand. He was evacuated to England on hospital ship New Haven. He held the rank of Lance Corporal when he was discharged on 19th December 1917 and was awarded a pension of 24 shillings per week, which was to be reviewed after 26 weeks. He was living at Beach Cottage in White House when he was admitted to the Belfast Union Infirmary, where he died of a combination of influenza and pneumonia at the age of 23. William Higgins was buried in the Belfast City Cemetery on 16th November 1918. Moving to the west of the province, the far west of the province, James Murray was born at Muff in County Donegal to George Murray and Bertha Murray, and he was married to Isabel Murray of Coolmore, Londonderry. James Murray was serving with the 9th Battalion Royal Inniskilling Fusiliers when he died of wounds at the age of 36 and is buried in Les Baraques Military Cemetery at Sangate in France. His widow received a dependence pension of 13 shillings and ninepence from May 1919. Thomas John O'Toole was born in Hong Kong to Joseph O'Toole and Catherine Frances O'Toole, and the family was living at Lisner Monaghan near Castle Caulfield in County Tyrone. Nearly all of Thomas John's siblings were also born in Hong Kong, so it can be assumed that Joseph O'Toole was in the army and stationed along with his wife in China and Hong Kong. Thomas John O'Toole died of bronchopneumonia at the age of 31 and is buried in the Mont Hune Military Cemetery at Le Tréport in France. He had enlisted with the Northumberland Fusiliers in Dublin and had joined the 12th Battalion in France in December 1915. You can see also on that headstone down at the bottom, also in memory of his brother Patrick, 13th Northumberland Fusiliers, died at Somme, 13th July 1916. Presumably, I haven't checked this, but presumably Patrick was one of the missing who's commemorated on the Thiepval Memorial. So the family have paid to have that engraving, that inscription, added to the only grave they have of one of their two sons who died in the war. James McCully was born on 22nd August 1898 at Coxhoe in County Durham to William McCully and Charlotte Dowding. William McCurry was originally from Newton Arch, which gives me a tenuous connection, and he was living at Little Francis Street in Newton Arch at the end of the war. Charlotte McCully had died in 1902 at the age of 37, and William, the father, and James, the son, were both working at a local coal mine in 1911. William was a storeman and James was a pony driver. James was living at Killow when he enlisted with the Yorkshire Regiment at Deaf Hill Colliery. So obviously the regiment went round the various collieries and had enlistment campaigns, recruitment campaigns at the men's places of work. Same thing happened in Belfast, where there would have been recruitment campaigns in the likes of Harnden Wolff's, Workman Clark, Mackey's, and all the other major industrial concerns. He was deployed to France with 10th Battalion in September 1915, and he also served with 12th Battalion and 5th Battalion of the Yorkshire Regiment. He died of sickness in a German hospital for prisoners at Liège, which the Germans called Lutetia. He was 21 and is buried in the Robermont Cemetery at Liège in Belgium. Samuel Curry was born in April 1889 at Barrow-in-Furness in Lancashire to John Curry and Caroline Hills. He was living at Sparman Street in Belfast when he married Martha Harvey of Ship Street on the 2nd of April 1911 at St Anne's Parish Church. So again, a bit of a tenuous connection. Two of their children were born at Kathleen Street in Belfast, and a third was born in January 1916 at Barrow-in-Furness. Samuel Curry served with the Army Ordnance Corps on the home front and died at the Cambridge Street Military Hospital in Barrow-in-Furness at the age of 28, and he's buried in the Thorncliffe Cemetery in the town. Martha Curry gave birth to a fourth child 16 days after the death of her husband. Martha received a pension of 33 shillings and ninepence per week from May 1919. The final case in tonight's short talk is John James Warling, who was born on 10th March 1892 to William Warling and Sarah Kyle, who farmed land at Mullochmore near Omagh. In 1911, John James Warling was a bookkeeper and he joined the Royal Air Force in October 1918. He was stationed at a motor transport depot in England when he died of influenza at the age of 26. His body was brought home for burial in the graveyard at Capa Church of Ireland. I'm going to read just the last two lines of Binion's poem, and although you're all muted, you're more than welcome to repeat the final portion after me. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.